One of the areas that I have real concern about, just because I hear about it so often and it wasn't an issue when I was growing up, is a lot of young guys in particular approach me because they're watching a lot of really intense pornography. And then, you know, another thing is happening. So a lot of young guys are getting all this arousal from watching other people have sex. And then they're in the real world scenario and it's like, wait, you're no longer third personing this. You're actually in this scene. And it's completely collapsing them.
We have to take a step back. And now knowing what we know about testosterone and dopamine and all these things, and ask, you know, what is pornography doing to the brain? People vary, but it should come as no surprise that a lot of these people have trouble with romantic interactions when they do happen. Their brain isn't conditioned to respond to those. With no judgment whatsoever, right? It's not a moral thing. What I do is I look at things through the lens of biology.
Pornography, it creates a strong dopamine rush. These are very primitive pathways that in some ways can overwhelm the dopamine system. Dopamine, it is that it is a non-infinite yet renewable resource. What do I mean by that? Just as adrenaline, epinephrine, is released in response to psychological stressors, physical stressors, cold water, final exams, you know, broken relationship, excitement. These are generic molecules, right? I mean, they're used to create activation states in the body. Dopamine is the molecule of motivation, pursuit, and desire. If you have too big a dopamine release. For instance, after a big win, sometimes we feel a crash and we need some time to reset. And that lower depression, sometimes people make the mistake of going out and pursuing more dopamine. We all should guard our dopamine peaks very carefully. A little bit goes a long way. A lot goes even further, but it also takes you down deeper afterwards. This is the basis of addiction. And there's an additional issue with pornography, which is not often discussed, which is that, remember, guys in particular, the brain is a learning prediction machine. And if your brain learns to be aroused by watching other people have sex, it is not necessarily going to carry over to the ability to get aroused when you're one-on-one with somebody else. You know, I'm not saying pornography as a stimulus is bad or good. What I'm saying is, in its availability and its extreme forms, it's a very potent stimulus. And very potent stimuli of any kind, extremely palatable food, extreme pornography, extreme experiences like bungee cord jumping, those set a threshold for dopamine release. And the higher the dopamine peak, the bigger the drop afterwards. And it's not that you drop to baseline, you drop below baseline. The crash that comes afterwards feels painful. And all that we need to do in order to return to a baseline of dopamine, renew that resource, is to wait and make sure that we don't try and trigger yet more dopamine in that time. So you asked about, should I be taking caffeine in addition to training and blasting music? I always say people differ on this spectrum, but be careful about stacking dopamine. Training itself is a stimulus for dopamine release. Cold water is a stimulus for dopamine release. But if you start doing training, cold water, listening to your favorite music, plus you're taking, let's say, some stimulant, doesn't obviously the stimulants we've been talking about are terrible, but some of the stronger stimulants out there,